is, has Teddy Bear been found?
No, he's in the pod somewhere.
We have a few at our house that if you need one. Let us calm ourselves and open our hearts, our ears, and our minds and listen to the great words and scriptures that the Lord has sent down to us. We're going to first start in Galatians 1, 11 through 24. Paul writes, "For I went to you, I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that the gospel that was proclaimed by me is not of human origin. For I do not receive it from a human source, nor was I taught it, but I received it through the revelation of Jesus Christ. You have heard, no doubt, of my early life in Jerusalem, Judaism. I was violently persecuting the church of God and was trying to destroy it. I advanced in Judaism beyond many among my people of the same age, for I was far more zealous for the traditions of my ancestors. But when God, who had set me apart before I was born and called me through his grace, was pleased to reveal his son to me so that I might proclaim him among the Gentiles, I did not confer with any human being, nor did I go up to Jerusalem to those who were already apostles before me. But I went away at once into Arabia, and afterwards I returned to Damascus. Then after 3 years, I did go up to Jerusalem to visit Cephas and stay with him 15 days. But did not see any other apostles except James, the Lord's brother. In what I am writing to you before God, I do not lie. Then I went to the regions of Syria and Cilicia, still unknown by sight to the churches of Judea and that of Christ. They only heard it said, 'The one who formerly was persecuting us is now proclaiming the faith he once tried to destroy.' And they glorified God because of me." We now go into Luke 7, 11, 17. "Soon afterwards, Jesus went to the town at night, and his disciples and a large crowd went with him. As he approached the gate of the town, a man who had died was being carried out. He was his mother's only son, and she was a widow. And with her was a large crowd from the town. When the Lord saw him, he had compassion for her and said to her, 'Do not weep.' Then he came forward and touched the bier, and the bearer stood still, and he said, 'Young man, I say to you, rise.' The dead man sat up and began to speak, and Jesus gave him to his mother. Fear seized all of them, and they glorified God, saying, 'A great prophet has risen among us, and God has looked favorable on his people.' This word about him spread throughout Judea and all the surrounding country." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. In the Gospel of John, in the next to the last chapter, John writes that Jesus did many other miraculous signs in his disciples' presence. Signs that aren't recorded in this scroll, but these things are written so that you will believe that Jesus is the Christ, God's Son, and that believing you will have life in his name. John almost always referred to Jesus' miracles as signs. He understood that the physical actions of Jesus' miracles in healing, casting out demons, and raising the dead were important to those whose lives were being personally touched at that very moment in time. But he also knew that these miracles that Jesus performed were signs of something even bigger than the immediate act, and that they pointed to something more, something greater, something that had the power to completely transform the world. And so he rightly referred to them as signs. In my quote from John 20, verse 31, John says that these signs, these miracles, that Jesus performed and that John recorded were so that you will believe that Jesus is the Christ, God's Son, and that believing, you will have life in his name. This morning, I want to look at our text from both Luke and Galatians and explore the possibilities of this new life that is available to us through Jesus Christ. In Paul's letter to the Galatians, he reminds the Galatians of what he refers to as his earlier life in Judaism. He reminds them that before he had a personal experience of the risen Jesus Christ, he was actually actively persecuting the church, the followers of Jesus. This man, Paul, whom many believe had had the greatest influence on the growth of Christianity because of his missionary outreach to those outside of Judaism, and because of his writings, of which we have 13 preserved in our Bible, started out by being the greatest persecutor of the early church. Paul was present at the stoning of Stephen. Paul had arrested and thrown into prison large numbers of Christians. Paul had overseen and or been involved in countless executions of other Christians. In fact, Paul was on his way from Jerusalem to Damascus, where he intended to arrest more Christians and drag them back in chains to Jerusalem, when he had his life-changing encounter with the risen Jesus himself. Through this encounter, God took the most violent persecutor of his followers and transformed him into arguably the most important man in the history of Christianity, save Jesus Christ himself. Talk about a new life. A murderous radical transformed into the man who is best known for what writing? What do you think is Paul's most famous writing? Most heard, most talked about? I'm getting all kinds of different ones. If you weren't a Christian, but you like to go to weddings, what do you think is Paul's first? 1 Corinthians 13. This man who persecuted the church is probably best known through weddings as the one who wrote about love. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions, and if I hand over my body so that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part, and we prophesy only in part, but when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now, we see in a mirror, dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide, these three, and the greatest of these is love. If God can give a new life to a man like Paul, God can give new life to you and to me. When we have chosen a path that leads to death, God calls us back with his love. God could have punished Paul, but instead he gave him new life and made Paul an instrument of his love. No matter what I have done, my sins do not rise to the level of a Paul. No matter what you have done, your sins are not unforgivable. God wants to take lives that are lived out in ways that bring death, spiritual death, emotional death, even physical death, and through his love, transform them into new lives that bring life to the spiritual dead, the emotionally dead, and those whose actions have even brought about physical death. God is a God of second chances. Another thing that we discover about Paul's life is that when Paul was transformed by the love of Jesus, his life took on new meaning and purpose. Those who have a relationship with God through Jesus Christ always have meaning and purpose in their lives. I can't tell you the number of people who I've spoken to over the years who tell me that their lives feel empty and meaningless. They talk about the endless days of getting up in the morning, heading off to their mundane daily routine, coming home at night, going to bed, and then starting what seems to be an endless routine over and over and over again. Day in and day out, this routine never seems to end. And they talk about their lives as if what they do doesn't really make a difference at all, doesn't matter in the bigger picture of things. It's just a routine that they have to go through. Like Paul, when we come into the new life given to us by God through Jesus Christ, our lives take on ultimate purpose and meaning. First, we begin to fulfill the very purpose of our creation, and that is to be in a loving relationship with God. The whole reason for our creation was so that God could pour out his love upon us and for us to love God. It is why we were created, to establish a loving relationship with God. For any relationship to be healthy, it requires attention. There is the attention that we pay in getting to know more fully the one whom we love. There is the attention that is paid in the learning of the language of our love as we learn how to communicate one with another in a way that is intimate and close and meaningful. And these things can only be accomplished by spending time with the one whom we love. In this case, we are talking about God himself. Prayer, worship, meditation, and the reading of God's love letters to us found in our Bible are the ways we stay and work on that relationship with God. And so the first purpose given to us in our new life found in Jesus is the purpose of developing our relationship with God. The second purpose that comes into our new life with God is the purpose of becoming like him. Paul, who had been a man of violence, discovered quickly in his relationship with God that God was a God of love. Not that God merely loved, but God was love. Paul speaks time and time again in his writings about the transformation that comes into our lives when we follow Jesus. He speaks of the intentionality of becoming like Jesus and moving from glory unto glory, by grace unto grace. It is not enough to know about God. We must become like God. God is slow to anger, quick to show mercy, full of compassion and grace, and abounding in love. Can we look at our own lives, our own reaction to the world, and say these things about ourselves? One way to check that out is to substitute your name in that sentence I just said. Instead of God, Chris is slow to anger, quick to show mercy, full of compassion and grace, and abounding in love. My guess is that doesn't have the same ring to it in women's ears as when I use God in there. We have work to do, a purpose to fulfill. We are to become like the God we love and bear witness to God's love to others. We also know that God has called all those who follow him through Jesus Christ to the ministry of reconciliation. Paul puts it this way in today's text from Galatians. God called me through his grace, was pleased to reveal his son to me so that I might proclaim him among the Gentiles. Paul could have said, God called me through his grace, was pleased to reveal his son to me so that I will go to heaven when I die. Or God called me through his grace, was pleased to reveal his son to me so that my sins would be forgiven. But no, Paul chooses to say that the purpose of his salvation was to proclaim God's love to the world. In 2 Corinthians, Paul puts it this way. See, everything has become new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. We are given a great purpose in our relationship with God, and that is to share the good news of Jesus Christ with the world. All four of the Gospels in our Bible have a section that has been called the Great Commission, the most famous of which can be found at the end of Matthew, where Jesus tells his disciples to go into all the world and make disciples of Jesus Christ, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey all that I have commanded you. What did Jesus command us? To love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. To love your neighbor as yourself. To love your enemy and pray for those who persecute you. This is why the mission of the United Methodist Church, the mission statement of the United Methodist Church is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. When God gives us new life, he gives our life meaning and purpose. A life of developing a deeper and deeper relationship with God each day. A life of becoming like God. And a life of sharing the good news of Jesus Christ with a broken world who is desperate for the message of God's love. And finally, from our gospel message this morning, we see that the new life that God gives us through Jesus Christ is a life of resurrection. As I started out this message, I talked about John's view of miracles as signs that point to something greater. In today's text from Luke, we see Jesus raised to life the only son of a widow. There is much that could be done with this text, but today I simply want to look at it as a sign. A sign that God, through Jesus Christ, has the power to give us a new life that will never die. It is through Jesus Christ that we are raised from the dead into an eternal relationship with God that will outlive our physical bodies. When these physical bodies give out and we return to the dust of the earth, God will raise us up to live in the glory of his presence forever. God is the God of second chances. God can take the most vile sinner and give him or her a new life. When we choose the path that leads to death, God calls us back with his love. God gives us new life. God is a God of purpose and meaning. When our lives feel out of control with no rhyme or reason, no purpose or meaning, God gives us direction and purpose. God gives us new life. God is the God of resurrection. When our physical lives give out, God raises us up to live in the glory of his presence forever. God gives us new life.